Yes, we are once again in the book room at the Royal Society. We're with Keith Moore, head librarian, Matt Parker, I don't know what to call him, like a YouTube guy. Mathematics guy, author of a book all about mistakes, which we'll come to later on. So today we're going to talk about some of the very few times, Keith, that even the Royal Society may have had the wool pulled over its eyes or been criticised a little bit, because, you know,
everyone makes mistakes.
They employed me, Brady, you know.
Well, that's when it all came to an end. They finally got things sorted out. The first thing we want to show you has something to do with something that fascinated me as a boy, and that is the Piltdown Man, which is like one of the most famous hoaxes of all time.
Indeed it is. It's the classic scientific hoax. So the race was on to find a British fossil man.
See, I hadn't come across this before.
We have here the exhibition of those famous fossils at the Royal Society. So these were the rather posh exhibitions at Burlington House. This is the Royal Society in 1913, the Conversazione, right? There's the coat of arms there with Nullius in Verba on it. Take nobody's word for it, but they did.
I love the irony. They did take his word for it.
Take nobody's word from it, apart from this one guy who found a fossil when no one else was looking.
The fossil finders, Charles Dawson is the famous one, and he's the one who probably propagated the hoax. But there were quite a few famous paleontologists involved in the whole story, and they gave credence to this group of fossils that they found at Piltdown.
It was in the council room.
That's right.
The most sacred of rooms at the Royal Society.
Rooms to Sully. Ah.
So Elliot Smith, F.R.S., fellow of the Royal Society, is exhibiting a brain cast obtained from the Piltdown skull and other specimens for comparison. So they're putting it next to similar types of skull and what they would call primitive man.
The objects in this comparative series are to illustrate and help in the interpretation of the distinctive features of the most primitive human brain to which we have access at present.
It was a mixture of human fossil remains, skull, and also the orangutan. So they kind of mixed and matched to produce what paleontologists would have really wanted to see, some of the features of what they thought an ape man ought to look like.
So it was an attempt to make the perfect missing link specimen.
One of the things they didn't have was one of the teeth, but later on they did indeed exhibit, found by Mr. Charles Dawson later.
He's had a good run of luck, that
guy. Yeah, a lower canine tooth of the Piltdown Man.
I don't believe you, Mr. Dawson, but if you find a tooth, then I'll
believe you.
He's like, I'll be back in a minute.
There were clearly scientists who had slight doubts about this. And it's only much, much later that the forgery is exposed. So it took a while.
Take no one's word for it.
I know.
It even says it on the badge. Yep.
I know.
Now, this is an interesting tome that I didn't know about. You know I love the Royal Society, Keith.
Yep.
And I know you do. And Matt, I'm pretty sure
Big
you
fan.
Do too. This is someone who doesn't seem like such a big fan. What's the story behind this?
This is Dr. John Hill, who's one of the famous characters in Royal Society history in the mid-18th century. He's almost elected to the Royal Society, but not quite. There's something about him that's a little off, and the fellows decide they don't really want anything to do with him. And he takes massive umbrage at this. He's not elected as a fellow. He publishes several books, of which this is one, really slating the Royal Society's standards of science.
Because they wouldn't let him in the club. He's like, right, well, I'm going to write several books about how I don't want to be in your club.
So he goes through the Philosophical Transactions and he pulls out papers that he thinks are ridiculous or contain bad science. He really does a hatchet job on them. This is an interesting book because it belonged to a fellow of the Royal Society, a guy called William Argeron, a naturalist, and he puts a response into John Hill. So you don't just get John Hill's kicking of the Royal Society, but you get William Argeron taking it out on John Hill. So this is a real scientific spat.
So he's written his responses in the margins.
Yeah. So you can see here the title page, a review of the works of the Royal Society of London, and Argeron's answering page, a lying and an abusive representation of the works of the Royal Society of London.
He's almost like doing a mirror.
He's done a satirical joke version.
Yeah, yeah.
All the way through the book, we have these handwritten and quite substantial number of and quite detailed responses to what is being written.
Oh, could you but have thrust yourself thus into good company? It might have saved you a deal of anxiety.
Feels very familiar to reading like a flame war online. Or there's like YouTube comments, but in slow motion.
Yeah. His name is checked right here.
He's underlined it.
Says, there's nothing by which a public body can so justly recommend itself to the world as by the invention and improvement of useful arts. The society whose publications are to be the subject of our animadversions will be found by the following chapters to have been sensible of this truth from its earliest establishment, and to continue perfectly convinced of it to this time. And the works of Captain Silas Taylor do honour to some of its first numbers of the Philosophical Transactions, and those of Mr. William Argyron to many of the later. So he's actually...
He's praising him.
That's quite complimentary of Argyron, isn't it?
He's actually saying this guy is one of the guys that actually is all right.
Yeah. So the response is, Mr. Hill, you would have lost a leg or an arm to have had but one half of the honour done to you.
So here's where he's saying, you're just upset because you're not in the club.
Yeah.
There's an interesting postscript to this here at the end.
The Committee of the Royal Society met 26th of March 1752, a year after the publication of this work, and reported that the Philosophical Transactions had hitherto been the work of the secretary only, that a committee should be appointed to, in future, consider the papers read.
So before that time, it was just the secretary going, this one, not that one, that this one.
Good. Yeah.
And now they're like, it can't just be one guy doing this. We need a team of people to check it.
The response is actually quite correct, and it's one that a modern scientist would recognise straight away. You don't just have one person judging these things. You have a committee of peers.
Peer review. Mm. And this is it. This is proto-peer review.
Well, that's a great book to have in the archives, but you're always after new ones, aren't you?
Oh, we are. Yeah, we love a book. Yeah.
Well,
it feels like you don't have enough books about mistakes and making mistakes.
Yeah.
And, you know, a real, shut up, Brady, a real fun look at mistakes. So I would like to present this copy of Humble Pie for consideration to go into the Royal Society archives. I can't help but notice you're not taking it off me, but that's
I can't
fine.
Accept it because we don't unless the author has signed it as these authors.
Oh, what do I write? Let me see how this one was introduced.
To the president.
To the president.
Of the Royal Society.
Oh, that's so good. I think it truly belongs in the archive.
Accepted.
Do you mind if I do some annotations? I want to do the margins.
The back.
I want to do the margins.
So good.
I'm going to do a hatchet job.
You're going
to do it. Our thanks to Audible for helping make this episode possible. Whether you're out walking the dogs, travelling, maybe just vegging out on the sofa, listening to audiobooks is a great way to pass time. And as Audible like to say, they can help you become a better you. And among Audible's mind-boggling array of titles is none other than Matt Parker's latest, Humble Pie. What better way to spend a lazy Sunday afternoon than having Matt himself spend 9.5 hours telling you all about mathematical mistakes? It's great fun, and great to hear Matt reading it. Now, Audible's got a great introductory offer. Your first audiobook plus 2 Audible originals for free. The originals are these extra special audio offerings exclusive to their listeners. Go to audible.com/objectivity or text objectivity to 500-500. And for your free audiobook, why not let Matt serve you up some humble pie? That's audible.com/objectivity or text objectivity to 500-500. Say we were voting for should Brady be a fellow of the Royal Society? And you can go, two ways we could vote here. We could do a yes and a no, or another way of voting is if you've got the white ball and the black ball and you're in a room full of other fellows, you can just put your hand in.
And no one can see.
No one can see which ball you're dropping. Oh, blackballed.
I was actually nice to you.
Oh, look, she kept the black ball.